نحن عم نعطيكم هلا الشيء لايف.
Live news.
شو هو هيدا الصوت؟ يا مشحرة فوت 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 عيمان فوت 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 يا ماما يا ماما يا ماما عيمان فوت بليز بليز فوت بليز بليز يا مشحرة يا الله
These were the shocking moments when a catastrophic blast tore through the heart of Lebanon's capital, Beirut. The cause? Incompetence at the very top.
The whole political reigning elite, they allowed this to happen, whether it's by pure negligence or if it was evil, both cases, they are completely guilty.
It's too much. It became normal to see people in this part of the world suffering. It's not okay.
In this city with so many connections to Australia, the pain and grief are immense.
And I just remember I was just screaming, my baby, help my baby.
Everything is really destroyed. The fabric of our generation and our time is really destroyed. It's really gone.
As the ABC's Middle East correspondent, Beirut was my city too. The blast wrecked my neighborhood, injured my friends, and stole hope from those who'd already endured so much. Tonight on Four Corners, the extraordinary story of how this disaster unfolded, told by the people who were there. Lebanon may be broken and broke, chaotic and forever on the verge of collapse. But for the 2 years I lived in Beirut with my family, it was a wonderful place, seductive and special. And it seemed safe, despite the ever-present reminders of the civil war.
Here's a Beirut scene, the Holiday Inn. The snow-capped mountains at sunset, and the children feeding fish on the pier.
The district shattered by the blast was our world. One cafe became an oasis for my family.
It's an old building with...
It was owned by Lebanese-Australian Omar Jahir, who pushed on as the economy collapsed around him.
You're living day by day. If you ask me what's going to happen in the next week, we really don't know.
Omar's wife, Hala, ran a successful yoga studio just around the corner. It was her sanctuary.
Especially in our kind of region where we live in the Middle East, it's really hard. Like, nothing is stable. Things keep on changing a lot. And if you're not able to find some sort of grounding and strength in your mind, then you'll be on Xanax very soon, on antidepressants, like all the Lebanese are, honestly.
While I was reporting there, Lebanon's problems drove its people to the edge. The currency crashed, jobs vanished, inflation tore into savings, and the nation's leaders had no solution. The frustrations fueled mass protests and nightly confrontations.
Well, I've been thoroughly tear gassed. It's not a very pleasant feeling.
burning throat, burning eyes. A lot of people here have it worse than me. I think this is the path of the next few months.
On the protest front line, I met Cherine El Zein, a campaigner for political change, who told me Lebanon's people had been abandoned by their leaders.
We don't have electricity. We don't have money. The banks took all our money. The government took our money. We have no work. We have no water. No education. Nothing. We have nothing.
It was about to get much worse. On August 4 this year, the midsummer heat was relentless and a COVID lockdown loomed. Dive instructor ALAA SAAD and his friends prepared an afternoon escape.
It's a meditation. This is why we love the hobby. It's a meditation when you go down below. It provides you with all the kind of calmness that you need and all the purity that you need down.
August 4 was the big day for a young Beirut couple.
Yalla go.
Amin Shamla and his fiancée, Hannah Fanu, were savouring the moment as they prepared for their wedding. They'd already put it off twice. Finally, they had just enough savings to pay for the event. Nothing was going to stop them.
كنت أول شيء كتير مبسوطة لأنه مثل أي بنت بتحلم بهيدا النهار تلبس فستان يصير عندها البارتي تاعيتها تكون هي مميزة حلوة كل شيء سبيشال عندها.
At one of the city's biggest hospitals, Australian-born doctor Stephanie Yacoub was nearing the end of a long shift.
And it was just one of those days where you haven't had anything to eat or drink, and we kind of joke about it with the residents that we were about to order some Maccas for everyone.
A few blocks from the hospital, another Australian, UN worker Sarah Copland, was at home with her husband Craig and their two-year-old son, Isaac.
He loved making people laugh. Like if you ever did anything and then somebody laughed, he would do it over and over again just to watch them. Watch them laugh.
Smart and outgoing, fearless in the face of Beirut's tough street cats, Isaac was thriving in this diverse city, moving easily between three languages.
Every time I came to pick him up, it was as if I was picking him up for the first time. He just was so happy and he broke onto the smile and he ran for me. And it was just such a beautiful moment. He had just the most beautiful smile.
Sarah was pregnant with her second child and the family had been trying to get back to Australia.
And they shut the airport.
We couldn't leave to get home. So we had made several attempts to get back this year and we were so close.
On that August afternoon, just before Isaac had dinner, he was in the lounge room with his mum, listening to his favourite song, Baby Shark.
He was funny, he used to change the names of the sharks to the names of his family members, so his grandparents, and as well as the kids in his nursery school. He would go through almost, you know, all the people he knew as make them sharks.
As the late afternoon sun finally softened, ALAA SAAD and his friends began their dive. When they surfaced, they spotted a fire ashore.
As soon as we came up on the boat, one of my colleagues, he's my buddy, and he was like, look behind you, the smoke is coming out big time from the port.
ALAA SAAD called a friend who worked at the port.
And we were asking what's happening over there. They mentioned initially that there is some kind of a warehouse containing paints that it was going on fire.
The nearest fire crew was based just a few hundred meters from the port. CCTV captured the moment they were alerted to the emergency at 5:54 p.m.
اجينا اتصال من غرفة عمليات شرطة بيروت لغرفة عملياتنا المركزية اللي هون بالكارانتينا انه في حريق عادي بالعنبر رقم 12 بالمرفأ ما اعطونا معلومات زيادة شو طبيعة الحريق ولا شو في بالعنبر رقم 12 مثل العادي ببعت انا فرقة اولية عبارة عن سيارة اطفاء وسيارة اسعاف في 10 اشخاص من ضمنهم الاكيب الطبي والاكيب اللي بده يطفي 10 اشخاص مع سيارتين.
The crew included three men from the same family. Sharbel Karam, his brother-in-law, and his wife's cousin, who was just 22 years old. As the crew left, Sharbel Karam called his wife at home.
كان بقلب الإسعاف. بيحكي مع بنته بصير يقول لها بابي ريغارد لي بومبيي نحن نازلين طفي اف كان كثير مبسوط فجاه بيقول لي ليكي بيلقى التليفون بيبرمه على السريع بيفرجيني خيي مارق من حده بسياره الاطفائيه مسرع كثير مسرع قال لي سكرة تنلحق خيك برجع بحكيك بعدين وما عاد حكينا
The church bells rang at 6 p.m. From his penthouse terrace, AGOSTON NEMETH was filming as the fire took hold.
I saw directly that there is a building in flames. I left my phone outside to film it.
Nearby, Lina Khalil and her husband Imad spent most afternoons on their balcony overlooking the port. On this day, from the 11th floor, they live streamed their view of the growing fire.
هن المهم يشيلوا انه ما يكون في حدا باذن الله حدا صار له شيء يعني ليش بدهم يطفوا ليطفوا
At 6:04 p.m. Lina filmed the arrival of the fire truck and the ambulance. The crews came in blind to a locked warehouse.
حرام ان شاء الله ما يكون حدا صار له شيء يا رب يا رب حدا صار له شيء
A paramedic on the ground with the brigade filmed the scene and captured the last footage of firefighter Sharbel Karam.
شخصين أو ثلاثة من عنا حاولوا يفتحوا الباب المستودع لأنه ما كان في حدا ناطرهم ولا حدا عم يوجههم إنه شو في جوا ناطرهم ولا مفتاح المستودعات والعنبر مع مين.
What the firefighters did not know was that the warehouse held 2,700 tons of ammonium nitrate. It had arrived in 2013 aboard a Mozambique-bound ship. The cargo was confiscated and moved to a dockside warehouse, hangar number 12, and abandoned.
We know that the Army intelligence since 2014 made a report to the government that there are highly explosive material at the port. And then in 2015, the head of the customs also had his own report on the matter. And then in 2019, another security apparatus in Lebanon also made such a claim on the port. And this report was sent to the government and to the presidency and to all of the security bodies in Lebanon.
The government was repeatedly warned about the dangerous material. Nothing was done. The final warning said the ammonium nitrate could cause the full destruction of the port.
This political system for years now has proven that it has an incapacity of decision making because of the different confessions in Lebanon and because of the veto power of all of the political parties in Lebanon. So once the administration or the security apparatuses in Lebanon do their job, if they do their job, it will reach the political level and then we have total inefficiency and incapacity to take any decision.
The whole political reigning elite that knew
about these explosives in the port of Beirut, at the heart of the city, is the main cause. Because they allowed this to happen, whether it's by pure negligence or if it was evil, both cases, they are completely guilty.
Agoston Nemeth's footage captured the seething blaze. There were fireworks stored in the warehouse alongside the ammonium nitrate, and a series of small explosions became a crescendo. Then, the first big explosion. And finally, catastrophe.
I don't even know if I jumped or the wave pushed me, but what I noticed the next second is that, or I don't know how long time after, that I was on the floor and my knee was bleeding a bit. I didn't know what just happened.
So we were seeing the smoke just having lights inside of it. We were hearing some kind of something boiling, like it's like the voice of the volcano when it's erupting.
Oh my
God. And I was thinking if I need to jump into the water to save myself from this wave coming towards us. And I couldn't even have the time to think twice about it when the wave struck us.
Smile, ya عريس, smile.
Come in. كنا معلم صور عم نركز شو بده وإذا ملاحظة كنت أنا عم بشوف هو مثلاً عم بيقلي زبط راسي كعملي هيك كنت أنا يعني ما كنت منتبهة أبداً شو في حوالي كنت بس مركزة معه وفجأة طلع الانفجار وتكسر الشفت يعني ازازة عم بيتكسر الشبابيك يعني حالي يعني مثل خلص انتهت العالم او ما بعرف شو صاير يعني بهذا النهار ما لازم يكون هيك بالنسبة لإلي انه لازم يكون غير
At St. George Hospital, Stephanie Yacoub was preparing to deliver a baby.
So I came into delivery ward. There were two patients who had already delivered, and there were two patients who were still in labor. One of them, Emmanuel, who was just about to have her baby. She was very close.
The father-to-be filmed the scene.
I stood at the door. At that moment prior, I started taking a video shot for a memory. I stopped at the door, and I asked them, is it possible that I can come in?
We were pushing the patient into the delivery room, and as the video shows, you know, I was helping the midwife push her into the room, and that's the moment where the explosion happened.
The blast ripped through the hospital. For Lina Khalil, who was still live streaming, fear became terror.
Please, food. Go inside. Go, Iman. سكر الإزاز بليز.
Less than 500 metres from the warehouse, activist Cherine El Zeyn filmed from the street. Cherine El Zeyn was knocked unconscious. Her phone continued recording.
For 2 minutes, it was silent. I don't remember anything. And then I think we woke up and we're starting asking if everyone is okay. And we're starting, after the dust was a bit less, we're starting seeing people walking with blood all over and screaming. People were screaming.
The blast wave tore through Jamaisi, Omar and Hulla's world.
Frankly, we didn't know if it was a strike, it was a bomb, is anyone bombing us? I just walked downstairs barefoot and I just felt I couldn't move my arm anymore. And I was covered in blood all over. I have stitches in my hair, bleeding from glass and my legs.
Their cafe was wrecked.
There were dead people on the streets. People were bleeding from everywhere. Buildings had already collapsed. It was absolutely nuts. And I got a hold of him on the phone and he tells me, I'm alive, but I need a hospital.
The blast wave roared through Beirut at more than 300 meters a second. Its full force struck the apartment of the Australian family, Sarah Copland, Craig Ollers, and 2-year-old Isaac.
I'm thinking this must be an earthquake because the whole building is moving. But I'm not otherwise injured at that point, and I flung open the door to see what was happening outside.
All of a sudden, I saw glass flying towards us, and I hit the floor. I was knocked to the ground. And then just when I got up, all I could hear was Craig running and screaming. He'd come from the bathroom and he was just screaming Isaac's name.
There were live wires dangling from the ceiling. It was total devastation. And of course, the first thing I thought of was, oh my God, where's Isaac? Where's Sarah? And I was stepping over all this broken glass, but I didn't care. I didn't feel all the glass cutting into my feet. My thoughts were entirely about the safety and well-being of my wife and my son. And when I got to the living room, I found Sarah leaning over Isaac, who was still in his high chair. And she was screaming, Isaac's hurt.
I could see that he was really really injured. He'd gotten a big piece of glass in his chest. Sure.
Do you need to stop?
I'm okay.
The moments after that were a bit blurry, but I do remember seeing this massive shard of glass sticking out of Isaac's chest right over the area of his heart. That's when I knew this was really, really serious.
So we were on the fourth floor and I just ran down the stairs. There was glass everywhere. It was cutting into my feet. You know, but I didn't even realize at the time that I had a huge thing of glass sticking out of my face. Just the adrenaline just kicked in because I didn't even feel that. And I just remember I was just screaming, my baby, help my baby. And I think people, I mean, I just can't imagine what we would look like, you know, because I know we were covered from head to toe in blood and he was crying and I had glass out of my face. And I remember this woman and she looked at us and she screamed at the sight of us. And I just kept on running. And at some point, Craig said, let me take Isaac. So I passed Isaac over to Craig. And I ran up to Charles Malik, and you know, Charles Malik is quite a busy road, and I just remember I ran right into the middle of the road and was waving my arms until someone would stop. This gentleman stopped, and I feel for him because he had his two young girls in the car, and I just think of how traumatized they must have been to see us. The poor things were crying. And as Craig said, we wanted to get to one of the closer hospitals, but it was impossible. He was like going down the wrong side of the road, gunning it as fast as he could. It was, you know, and I was, anytime we got to an intersection, I was screaming at everyone to get out of the way. And then we arrived at the hospital and they took him immediately. And because I was injured, I had a lot of cuts all over my body. They took me straight away to another part of the hospital. And that was the last time I saw Isaac, was the doctors taking him one way and me the other.
So Sarah and I agreed that I should stay with Isaac just so that Isaac would know that his parents were still with him, that he wasn't alone. So that went on for a while, and he was undergoing medical attention for at least what felt like an hour and a half, 2 hours. But the heart monitors had started flatlining much earlier than that. I tell you what, no parent should ever have to be in the same room as his child who's on an operating table and see the heart monitor flatline and hear all the alarms go off. And that flatlining sound and the sounds of the alarms going off is something that's gonna stay with me for the rest of my life.
Right across the city, stories of life and death played out. Amid the devastation at St George Hospital, Dr. Stephanie Yacoub focused on a mother and her unborn baby.
I just went back to basics, and at that moment I was like, I need to hear the baby's heartbeat. I needed to make sure that that patient and her baby were okay. We got the glass off of her and the bed that she was on. We were also able to drag her away from the window and towards an area that was a little bit more safe and not as exposed, just in case there was going to be more, exposure to broken glass.
With casualties everywhere, Dr. Yacoub performed CPR on a nurse but couldn't save her. One of 21 deaths in the hospital. The doctor recorded a brief message for her worried family.
And I'm fine. Nothing is wrong with me at all. No bleeding or anything.
They told us we're going to deliver no matter what. They told my wife, you got to focus and we need to go through this because we can't go back. We have to deliver.
The sun was setting and we had to deliver him with the use of our friend's flashlight from her phone.
Baby George was born at 7:18 p.m. into the chaos of a failing state, weakened by greed and self-interest, and a lack of care for its people. The blast was the awful culmination of that carelessness. The scale of the destruction was overwhelming. Every building within 2 kilometres of Ground Zero was badly damaged. Thousands of homes uninhabitable. This was the brand new apartment of the couple who filmed the fire from their balcony, Imad and Lina.
قديش بعيد كيف بدي اتخيل انه يوصل لعندي على قلب البيت يعني ليكي شوفي عندك مساحه لهونيك الحمد لله احسن من غيرنا الحمد لله عنا عندنا ايدينا واجرينا والله يشفي كل اللي تصاوبوا والله يرحم كل الشهداء لانه جريمه هاي صارت فينا
Imad needed 6 hours of surgery.
رح ارجع افتح عيني ولا رح فيني ارجع بتذكر لما فقت قلت رح فيني ارجع امشي عشان ما عرفت ما بعرف قد ايه الدامج كان
حبيبي انت
بطل
نو في اكيد في وجع بس يعني كمبير للي كنت فيه من اول لهلا الحمد لله احسن بمليون مره اكيد اول شيء ما كان فيه يمشي هلا عم بمشي شوي اكيد في غضب اكيد في حدا مسؤول على اللي صار بس مثل ما بقول هذا لبنان انه لازم تتوقعي كل شيء انه شو مين في عقل باي دوله بالعالم بيخلوا هالكميات حوالي العالم مناطق سكنيه انه مين بيعملها اي دوله بالعالم تكون مسؤوله تعمل هيك ما في دوله بالعالم تعملها
The problems in Lebanon seem endless. But this death and ruin caused by ineptitude, it's too much. All 10 fire crew members sent to the blast were killed. At their station house, there's grief and anger.
لا بالعكس لو حطونا بالصورة انه والله في عناصر في مواد ممكن تنفجر تحت كنا تصرفنا بصورة عكسية. كنا ما بعثنا حدا لتحت على الموت كنا طلبنا من الأجهزة الأمنية تحت تعمل إخلاء للمنطقة خففت أضرار أكثر يمكن
بعدنا بأول الطريق بعد ما فينا نقول هيدا الشخص هو المسؤول بس إن شاء الله نقدر نوصل لنهار نقول فيه هيدا الشخص هو المسؤول أكيد ما في شي بيردلنا أطيب شباب عنا بالعائلة ما في شي بيردلي لا خيي ولا جوزي ولا ابن عمي بس نحن بدنا نضل تنعرف مين كان الشخص
This young couple was lucky to emerge unscathed from the trauma of August 4. Just hours after they ran for their lives, Amin and Hana had a scaled-down wedding. As they start a life together, they have little optimism for their country.
يعني أكتر من هيك ما بعتقد في وصف أن يوصف حالة لبنان أو البلد. يعني نحن إلا اقتصاد كان منيح وفاينانشالي ما كنا منيح سياسيا ما كنا منيح ما كان عندنا قطاع بالمرة بلبنان ماشي حاله لحتى نقول إنه إجا الانفجار خرب هول القطاعات لا نحن أوريدي كنا عم نحتضر وإجا الانفجار شال تيوب الأكسجين يمكن اللي كنا عم نتنفس منه هيدي هي
Look at this one. Wow. Fucking hell. This one is ripped apart.
Actually, we had one of the guys in the hospital when Omar was there. Yeah. He lives in this building. And his wife lost her eye in this building. Yeah. Oh my God, so sad.
My friend Omar and his wife Hala returned to their cafe.
This is the first time I actually see the place. We kind of lost all the machines. All the furniture is gone. Our facades are gone, the glass, the skylight. I'm quite concerned about the structure. It's unfortunate. Oh, well.
What should we do now? Where do we go from here? I mean, even if we receive funds, do we have any trust that we will not fail again and they will destroy us again? And we will build for what? I mean, we have successful businesses, but they made sure to make us fail. They locked our monies in the bank, so basically stole our money.
Oof, I forgot about that.
Yeah, so even if we want to build, where to build from? And even if we get funds, to build for what? Our money has devalued by 80%. The street that we live and work on has completely destroyed. That's too much. It became normal to see people in this part of the world suffering. It's not okay.
Omar needed surgery to remove the glass embedded in his feet. He's a wreck. His home is in even worse shape.
حبيبي حبيبي عبدو عبدو في فوت على البناية ما هيك شاو لك
Omar was reunited with his neighbor Abdul.
قالوا لك سألت عنك بس قالوا لك قالوا لك بسأل عنك؟
ايه
قول له نعيش هون اوعى تفكر هون انت بدي اياه تصير بيتك سوا
اعطيه بوسه من راسك بدي بوسك انا بدي بوسك
اوعى
It's heartbreaking. It's too much. It's too much. And I don't even like to see the video anymore of the actual explosion. When I see it online, I skip it. I don't want to see it anymore. You know, it's not something that I want to... I'm not going to forget what they did to us, but it's something that I want to forget what happened.
His house may be a write-off, but the cafe is reopening.
The glass is in. I'm amazed there's this much glass in Lebanon.
To be honest, I'm amazed as well, because we didn't even have delays in delivery of the glass. Like, I ordered it, and the next day I had glass installed. I'm like, it's crazy. Did we have that much glass in Lebanon?
Somebody knew.
Yeah, someone knew.
Well, I've got really mixed feelings looking at the cafe because I spent so many happy hours there. It's great to see it back, but God, the cost on you and Hala and the staff as well. It's been brutal.
Yeah, you just gave me goosebumps, Adam, honestly. Because really, we've had some great times in the cafe and even in Lebanon. We feel like the old Lebanon, I don't know how we're going to rebuild. Everything is really destroyed. The fabric of our generation and our time is really destroyed. It's really gone.
Yay, Daddy. Ya Allah.
Baby George is doing well.
Daddy, Daddy.
His doctor, Stephanie Yacoub, wants to stay in Lebanon to finish her medical training.
I can't deny that I'm feeling anxious being here because my last experience here was definitely devastating and tragic. But I'm also very proud. So many people are working on fixing up this hospital. It's a construction site right now. And I think that's proof that the Lebanese people are, unfortunately, I know everyone is right against this word right now, but we are resilient and we pick up.
Oh, his ultrasound photos.
Sarah and Craig are back in Perth.
First moment.
Their second child is due this month. They're haunted by the fact that they should not have been in Beirut at the time of the explosion. Well before the disaster, they had tried and failed to get flights home. There were none available.
Just 3 weeks difference and our whole lives would be... would just be the way that they were supposed to be.
Absolutely. The way that,
yeah. Yeah. Isaac would be here running around with his grandparents rather than us visiting him in a cemetery.
What happened to Isaac was a terrible tragedy, but it was by no means the only tragedy that happened that day. And we've been able to leave and deal with our pain somewhere else. But there are people still living in Lebanon that have to deal, have to confront the reality of their situation, which is that things have not yet changed as much as the Lebanese people would like to ensure that that suffering stops and that they're safe. And yeah, my heart really goes out to them, and especially the children there.
And I think while I can't foresee us ever going back, just because the pain is too great, I will always remember the kindness and the compassion of all the Lebanese people towards us. People have lost so much as well. Our Lebanese friends took the time to be with us, took the time to help us, even though they were suffering due to the economic crisis, even if they had lost their homes in the explosion, they took time to bring us things that we needed and look after us. They loved our little boy like he was family, so I have a lot of love for the Lebanese people who have lost more than most Australians could ever possibly imagine and yet still have so much to give.